Good morning to each and everyone in the house today, as well as those watching on YouTube. Today we've got a very special Sunday. We have our certificate Sunday for those who completed the World Needs a Father and the Mother Design courses. And then we've got somebody very special with us, and that is Marius and Kai from Open Doors, and they are going to come and share with us and assist us and give us all the everything that we need to know. They've got a table here on the side with all the information and books and so on. So after the service, you're welcome to come and talk to them, and they will help you. You want to buy some of the books, or there are pamphlets and stuff as well, and I'm sure Marius will explain a little bit more about that. And I think they are here, and he will tell you more about that as well, but to raise awareness about what is happening all over the world regarding the persecuted church. And I mean, it's part of the body of Christ, part of us. And you know, they really need our support. And Marius is going to share with us. So, welcome to the two of you. We really appreciate it. Marius, you can come to the front and you can come and share with us. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. It's a privilege for me to be here today. For me, it's especially a special occasion, because I am originally from Vanderbijl Park. In fact, I was born here, and I attended school here as well. So for me, it's really special to be back here. Thank you again to Mike and Steph for this opportunity, for making all the arrangements. You know, I would never have guessed that I would have the opportunity to speak at a church in Vanderbijl Park when I grew up and when I attended school. So it's really, I give God the honor. I would never have expected that God would have used or called me in this way. Now, as Pastor Mike has said, I am Marius. With me today is Kai. We are both volunteers from Open Doors. We both are full-time employed, so we do this as an honor and as a answer to God's call to work in His kingdom. In my professional career, I work in the government. I won't so say which department. I don't want you to hold it against me. But it's not such. So, how many of you, if I may ask with a show of hands, are aware of the work of Open Doors? So, not too many. You know, we are an organization that was formed in 1965. It makes us 69 years old. So, if you decide to get involved with Open Doors as an organization, you know you get involved with an organization that has a long track history. It's a reputable organization that does great work. Our mission is to support the persecuted church. And as Pastor Mike said, our main focus is actually to spread awareness, because the reality is people are not aware of the extent of persecution worldwide. So today my aim is to tell you more about the trends and statistics in respect of Christian persecution worldwide, to mobilize the church to pray with us, and if the Holy Spirit so leads you, to get involved in the plight of the persecuted church. Now, you may ask how prevalent persecution is. On the screen you may see a picture of a young man. His name is Manga. He's from the northern part of Nigeria. We recently had the pleasure of meeting with Manga when he shared his testimony. Now, Manga says he was at home one night with his parents when Boko Haram attacked their house and robbed them. They took the men outside, bound their hands behind their backs and forced them to their knees. They had two questions. Will you convert to Islam and will you reject your Christian faith? To both questions, all three of them, that's Manga, his father and his brother, answered negatively. They then proceeded and decapitated his father in front of them. They had to endure and see this. Following this, Manga and his brother's throats were slit. But they did so in an attempt to cause as much damage as possible. It was only by God's grace that Manga survived. And that in itself is a whole testimony on its own. But what stood out to me from Manga's testimony was that he said, you know what? You guys here in the West, you're actually far worse off. And I asked, but how could that be? And he said, no, we as Christians in Nigeria, especially in the northern part, if we are murdered, we only go to be with Christ. But he says, you here in the West, there are so many distractions. And it kills the soul. And he reminded me of Matthew 10:28 that says, do not be afraid of the one who can kill the body only. You know, that was the story of Manga. Is his story unique? Unfortunately not. On the screen you'd see, second from your left is AJ. He's from India, in the northern part of India. He was the first in his family to convert to Christianity. When his family found out, he was forced from his home. His last words to his father was, Dad, Jesus loves you. With these words, and with prayers, AJ's whole family converted to Christianity. Soon after, they were kicked out of their village. They went to another village and they started a church. Now, in May of last year, there were violent attacks on Christians in the Manipur province. And on the picture, you may be able to see, this. They're standing in their church, and you can still see some of the damage that was caused by these attacks. On the picture is Fadi, a young man from Egypt. On the 15th of May last year, he was murdered on these construction sites you see in the back. Fadi had a dream of becoming an architect. He was studying architecture and was working to finance or fund his studies when an Islamist extremist thought it was a good idea to kill him for his faith. Now, yearly, Open Doors compiles the World Watch List. This is a list that lists the top 50 countries where the most severe persecution happens. Now, when the list is compiled, only well-documented and corroborated incidents are reported or reflected. So, in reality, the real state of persecution is much higher. Now, you may not be able to see all the detail on the map, and therefore I urge you to join with me and Kai after the presentation at our display, where we have this World Watch List that you can take home with you, with lots of other valuable information, which you can then include in your prayer life. But basically, this state shows us where the top 50 countries is with the worst persecution. And unfortunately, North Korea is always, and has been, except for about 2 years ago when Afghanistan was the number one, has always been in the number one position. On the screen, I want to refer your attention to some of the statistics, just to give you an idea of the prevalence in the incidences of persecution. When you consider these statistics, bear in mind that these figures represent persons. It's not just numbers. And again, like I said, the numbers are actually quite probably much higher, because we only record well-documented and corroborated incidents. But you'll see that just do less than 5,000 murders that we are aware of as an organization in the last year alone. And perhaps more shocking is that 90% of all these murders happened in one place, and that was the northern part of Nigeria. Traditionally, the northern part of Nigeria has always been mostly Islamic, and the southern part Christian. However, the violent Muslim extremists has now also, well, recently started to move their attacks southward. So 90% of these murders were just in Nigeria. And this is where we find the testimony of Manga so relevant to explain the situation in certain parts of Nigeria. You'll see that close to 43,000 violent attacks. So these are attacks that didn't lead necessarily to a murder or death, but still violent attacks where Christians were attacked and assaulted with weapons and injuries were sustained. 14,700 churches and schools operated by Christians were destroyed. You can imagine the impact. These people have no place to go. That's why the next statistic refers to 21,000 attacks on Christian homes. Imagine being desolate, you have no place, destitute, you have no place to go to. And if you want to return to your village, you will be attacked again. And a lot of these brothers and sisters of ours, they live off the land. So this attack on their houses have dire consequences. You see that 278,000, just in one year, Christians displaced. Our brothers and sisters that now have to go to refugee camps where they live in abject poverty, where they live in makeshift tents and things like that, where they don't have access to schools, they don't have access to medical assistance and the like. Now, these figures represent 365 million Christians worldwide that is under persecution. That is one in seven. And I think this will put things in perspective. One in seven, yet here we are today. We are free to attend church. We are free to read from our Bible. We are free to express our faith. Yes, in South Africa, like other Western countries, there is some force being exerted on religious freedom, especially Christian freedom, but we do not normally have to worry about violent persecution. In fact, last year, 24th of December, between 24 December and 26 December, there was well-planned and orchestrated attacks in Nigeria, specifically planned for those days because it's a special and holy day for Christians when we celebrate Christmas, the birth of our Christ Redeemer. In this attack, 36 towns were attacked in one night. In the process, 300 Christians murdered. 80,000 of them were displaced in one night. Can you recall that you heard about this on the mainstream media? No. This is not something that is ordinarily reported in the mainstream media. Therefore, it's important for us as an organization, especially to focus on spreading awareness so that you can be aware of the extent of persecution. And like I said, even here in South Africa, we are not immune. You know, the recent Bella Act and the Hate Speech Act all have the inherent possibility of limiting religious freedom. On the screen is a lot of valuable information. Again, I would invite you to take some of the pamphlets home with you because, again, the information is a bit difficult to read from the screen and there's a lot of information there. But what stands out for me here is that with specific focus and reference to the continent of Africa, the most violent countries in Africa is Nigeria, Cameroon, Burkina Faso, the CAR, Mozambique in fifth place, DRC, Tanzania, Mali, Niger, and Sudan. Now, I think it's important to note that Mozambique is in the fifth position, which is our northern, on our northern border. So it's not something that is far off. Now, our founder, Brother Andrew van der Vale, yes, he shares your town's surname, he had several excellent sayings, and one of them was, you only find two kinds of people. Those who say persecution will never happen here, and those that say can't believe it happened here. So I encourage you, those of you who have not read his book, we have it on sale here as well after this service. You can attend to our table, but you'll find this book an amazing read and a valuable resource in equipping you to pray for the persecuted church. Also on this slide, which is very important, is the population in the Africa continent is estimated to be 1.2 billion people. And I think this just explains to us the dire need for more laborers, the need for the church to get involved in the body of Christ, to get involved in mission organizations, to ask that God will guide us, the Holy Spirit to show us where our talents are, so that we can apply our talents and our gifts in God's kingdom. Now, why is there persecution? I quickly read to you from Matthew 10. You can follow with me on the screen if you want. Verse 21, it says, brother will betray brother to death, and the father his child. Children will rebel against their parents and have them put to death. You will be hated by everyone because of me, but the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. In verse 23, the first part, when you are persecuted in one place, flee to another. Jesus is telling us here that we are to expect persecution. We are to expect opposition to his message. It is not something that should come as a surprise. And in fact, perhaps rather more relevant is, if we do not experience any persecution, perhaps we should wonder why that is. It could also be that things are so easy for a reason, and that in fact could be a form of an attack on your faith. We also read in 2 Timothy 3 verse 12 that everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ will be persecuted. So it's not a question of whether we will or may not, we will be persecuted. The world hates the message of the gospel. This is why Jesus commanded us to be as shrewd as snakes and innocent as doves. I think especially important here is verse 23. It tells us there's a time to flee also. In fact, even Jesus, when he was a baby, you'll remember that Mary and Joseph fled with the baby Jesus to Egypt. And on occasion when the Pharisees wanted to stone Jesus, he walked through them. So we don't necessarily always have to pay the highest price when we are persecuted. We are to apply our minds to the situation and pray to God to guide us, how to deal with the persecution at that moment. But we have to be prepared. If we do not expect persecution, or we do not know that there is such a thing, how are we going to be prepared? How are we going to react? Why should we care? Most of us would think that our persecuted brothers and sisters are there in far off countries. Why should we care? Why should we get involved? We read in 1 Corinthians 12, 26 that if one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. That's why we must care. We are all brothers and sisters in Christ. We're part of the same body. We cannot be apathetic towards the plight of our brothers and sisters merely because we are separated by distance. In Hebrews 13, verse 3, we read, continue to remember those in prison as if you were together with them in prison, and those who are mistreated as if you yourselves were mistreated. We are all called to make disciples. It doesn't mean that we are all to become missionaries, or that we should all become street evangelists. You pray to the Holy Spirit to guide you and to develop your specific gifts and talents. Shortly, I'd like to play you a video. It's only about 2 minutes long. It shows the evolution of persecution over the past years, since 1993. The darker the red, the more violent the persecution is. So this is an evolution from 1993 to 2023. I urge you to specifically pay attention to the continent of Africa. You see that in 1993 there were only 40 countries that suffered persecution, which almost doubled, 73 in 2023. The next couple of slides focuses on the continent of Africa, and you'll see how persecution has increased over the years. This video is also available on YouTube if you search for Open Doors. So because there's a lot of information in the video, it's short, so you can view perhaps in your own time as well. The next part of the video deals with the reasons behind the persecution, why there's persecution. This ranges from even organized crime, corruption, and that type of thing, or a political system. This is Islamic oppression, which is most prevalent, as you can see. Next slides are the persecution in Asia, which differs mostly for the reason for the persecution. But you can also see that persecution in Asia has increased dramatically. Slides will focus on the main triggers for the persecution in Asia, which you'll see is post-communist oppression or dictatorial paranoia, especially northern Korea, or religious nationalism, Islamic oppression. So the question is, will you stand with them? Will you support them? Will you assist the persecuted church? The next slide lists some factors we as a local church can engage in to prepare for persecution. I will discuss this perhaps with you after the service. But what can you do? You can support us firstly by praying for us, using this information that you received today to pray for our persecuted brothers and sisters. What we don't know, we don't pray for. But please take some of the pamphlets and include this in your daily prayer lives. You can download the World Watch List. You can take a copy of it. There's other means you can get involved. You can also volunteer, like Kai and I, to become speakers or presenters. So there's several ways that you can get involved in the mission of serving the persecuted church. And when you pray, pray that God would strengthen and be with those brothers and sisters in these countries. Pray for wisdom and courage as they live for Christ. And pray that help and effective help would reach them. You know, that's also another reason that the World Watch List is so valuable. It assists us as an organization to inform us where to apply our resources. On the table there is a form that you can use to sign up to receive our newsletters. I urge you to strongly consider completing at least the first part so that you can receive our emails. If you do complete this, please leave the form behind when you leave. If the Holy Spirit so leads you, there are also other manners in which you can get involved on the rest of the document. On the screen is my contact information. I'm also available to do this type of presentations at schools or other smaller groups, should the need arise or you have such an opportunity. I want to close off by just thanking you again and thanking Pastor Michael for this opportunity, granting Open Doors this opportunity and this platform to speak to you today, to inform you about the extent and the nature of the persecuted church. Thank you.
Marius, thank you so very much. We really, really appreciate it. Guy, thank you for coming along as well. I want to promote the book, God's Smuggler. In Afrikaans, it's available as well, God's Smokkelaar, by Brother Andrew. It's a very old book, and it's absolutely wonderful to see the hand of God, you know, in what he did and what he did for God and for the persecuted Christians as well.